Come on, bless and praise our God. Anybody know our God is worthy to be praised? Anybody came to worship? Where my worshipers at today? Amen, amen. God is certainly worthy to be worshipped. I am grateful to be here this morning, and I'm thankful to God. For yes, this is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. I'm so delighted and honored to bring to us a dear friend of mine, a cohort of mine. We both graduated on yesterday, and I won't tell y'all, it's been a tough journey pastoring through this pandemic, and I've been going nonstop throughout the whole pandemic. And it was time to just pause and get a little rest and allow some of these giants who were in town this week. I said, if you all are staying over, just stay over and preach for us. Hope will be the better because of these brilliant young men who shared with me during classroom time. And this particular brother, we've become extremely close, and I thank God for his friendship and fellowship. And we are almost like two peas in a pot when it comes to school and professors and so forth. And so this was my running buddy, the pastor, the Reverend Dr. McKinney Jackson. Amen. Will you help me celebrate and give thanks to God for Pastor Jackson? His family is here, and I'll give him space to introduce them. But we're grateful they're here, and we're thankful for our soloists being here as well. Sister Pamela Allen, amen. She's going to come and bless us with two more numbers, and the next voice you will hear will be none other than our speaker for this hour, Reverend Dr. McKinney Jackson. Give them both a great big hand.
When you're lonely and your heart is filled with nobody like him. Mighty in battle, gentle enough to know me, gentle enough to love me. Nobody like you, God. And we bless your name. Hallelujah.
people said amen. First, giving unto God to pastor of this church, my friend, my brother, Pastor Jose Hopkins. Come on, let's give him a hand clap of praise. And to the ministers, officers, and to this august body of baptized believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, God is good. And we definitely thank God for his unmerited favor and his blessings toward us. I am extremely grateful to share this preaching moment here at this very fine church, and I want to thank your pastor publicly for allowing us this opportunity to share our convictions concerning our Christ. We've been partnered together in class for over for the past 3 years. We sat together, learned together, traveled together, studied abroad together, and then we finished together. And so whenever I needed inspiration, I'd call your pastor and ask him, has he finished writing his paper yet? He'd say no. And I'd tell him, I don't feel so bad now. Thank you for the inspiration. And vice versa, he'd call me, Jack, you got that assignment? And sometimes I say, what assignment? He said, well, I don't feel bad because I ain't going to be last. At least I got 3 pages. You ain't got started. So we helped each other to get through class. And I didn't know your pastor was that smart, but he's a pretty smart fella. And to the First Lady, God bless you, who allowed us to just take over the house and allow us fellas to get together and fuss about some of the assignments that we had to do. They were unmerciful at times. Amen. And so we give honor to the First Lady, and then, amen. And then my family came up all the way from Fort Worth, Texas. They're here. And I'm grateful. Now, I'm not going to hold you long this morning. I want to share with you a brief word. My preaching buddy, friend, they told me that he just showed out at the 8 o'clock. Amen. And so I'm glad that he did. That means I don't have to do too much at the 11 o'clock. But there is a word I want to try and lift that is chronicled, couched, and concealed in the confines of the Old Testament. The 27th number of the psalm. I want to cast a sermonic spotlight on the first 6 verses, Psalms 27, beginning with verse number 1. And it says that the Lord is my light, my salvation, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life, of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat of my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though an host should camp against me, my heart shall not fear. The war should rise against me. In this will I be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret place of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me upon a rock. And now shall my head be lifted up above my enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing. Yea, I will sing praises unto the Lord. I want to talk about how to hold on during tough times. How to hold on during tough times. When you look at this particular pericope, this particular Psalms, this particular Psalms is a deeply spiritual psalm and one that is very familiar to many of the children of God. This particular psalm is broken down into at least two dichotomies or divisions. The first dichotomy or division deals with the first six verses. And these six verses speaks of the privileges God makes for the encouragement and comfort of his people. The second division or dichotomy is verses 7 through 14, which is a prayer of help and substance. Tell me, David, how can we hold on during tough times? Tell me, David, how can we keep the faith when it seems as if my vision is distorted? Tell me, David, how can I hold on when it seems as if my blessings have been put on layaway? Tell me, David, how can I survive when it seems as if my dreams are short of coming true? Tell me, David, how can I keep the faith when I'm trying to work in the church only to discover that there's just as many hypocrites in the church than there are on the street corners? Tell me, David, how can I hold on during tough times when I go to the doctor for a physical and he in turn tells me that I have some terminal disease? Tell me, David, how can I keep the faith when it seems as if my pilgrimage is not productive? Tell me, David, how can I survive when it seems as if God has misplaced my file? Tell me, David, how can I hang in there when I've lost touch because I'm out of touch? Tell me, David, how can I hold on when it seems as if the bottom has fallen out? Tell me, David, how can I hang in there when I am going cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs? Tell me, David, how can I hold on during tough times? Well, David helps us to put what I like to call an ecclesiastical bandage on our wounds of worry. David says we can hold on during tough times, number one, because we have God's provisions. I ain't making up, it's right there in verse number one. He says, for the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Now, if I was going to really deal with verse one, it would take me several weeks just to get off of the first three words. The Lord is. Is my microphone on? If I was going to really just deal with verse one, it'd take me a while to get off of those first three words, because it's hard to comprehend everything that the Lord is. It's hard to describe in a sentence or two what the Lord really is. You'll have to take some time. When you start talking about what all he is, it takes a while. I wish I had some help in here. What is it? He's my battle axe in the time of battle. What is it? He's my midnight rider. He's grandma's leaning stick. What is it? He's food when I'm hungry, water when I'm thirsty, shelter in the time of storm, lily of the valley, rose of Sharon. It takes a while to describe, and every time I try to describe what he is, I have a want for sense of inadequacy because I just can't tell all of what he is to me. Woo. So David, the writer, takes this broad perspective of God. And he narrows it in by saying that the Lord is my light. That word light literally means guide. David says, I have God's provisions because he guides me. Or literally, he directs me. I can't go wrong, literally, because he's leading me. Are y'all still with me here? I know that Pastor Deborah Mack adequately described it in Psalms 23, but it links right there. In verse 2 of Psalms 23, he says, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures. And here we go. And he leadeth me beside the still waters. He restored my soul. Here it goes again. And he leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. I know that wherever God guides, he provides. He's leading me. Is that all? He says, not only is the Lord my light, he says that the Lord is also my salvation. Do y'all see that right there? David suggests that the very fiber of his existence hinges upon God and his love. Okay, I didn't get some of y'all. Let me see if I can put it like this. I can't make it without God. But God can make it without me. When I pronounced that word salvation, I heard one of the deacons on the front row say, yes, he's my everything. Is my microphone on? I think we missed our cue to say amen right there. God is our everything. Okay, one more time for clarity. God is our everything. Do I have a witness right there? He says, I have God's provisions because God not only provides for me, but he watches over me. He takes care of me, and I have to depend on him, the God who not only made everything, but knows everything. Is it all? He says, not only is he my light, not only is he my salvation, but he also says that the Lord is the strength of my life. God not only gives life, God also empowers life. Let me hit rewind and say it again. God not only gives life, but God also empowers life. Okay, let me see if I can make it a little clearer. Have you ever answered the phone and the news that you heard on the other line changed the course of your day? Okay, have you ever heard any news that when you got off the phone, the only thing you could do was just go get into bed? It was so painful, it was so disturbing that whatever else you had planned for the day got canceled. The only thing you wanted to do was just get into bed and be left alone with unanswered questions, not knowing how you were going to get through this particular ordeal, not knowing how you were going to channel through it. You know that money couldn't help you. Who you knew downtown couldn't help you. The only person that could help navigate you through life circumstances was the one that was up above. Anybody ever been there before? You didn't know how. You didn't know how, but you did know who. I wish I had some help in here. And all I'm trying to tell you is that when life seems as if it's getting the best of you, whenever life seems to treat you unfairly, there is a God who sits high and he leans over the balcony of heaven and he'll help you to get through what you can't get through on your own. In other words, God will give you the strength to make it through it. Now that's a word for somebody, because you need to understand that God does not always remove what you're going through. Good God Almighty. I want to say that again. Just because you pray does not mean that God is going to remove it. But what God will do is that God will give you the strength to make it through it. It was Paul that prayed. He says, I asked God to remove this stone that was in my sight. I prayed 3 times. And he said to me, Paul, I'm going to give you something better. I ain't going to remove the thorn. But I'm going to give you something else that's better. I'm going to give you my grace. And you need to know that my grace is sufficient. And Paul discovered that when I'm weak, that's when he makes me strong. And my brothers and my sisters, if you never go through anything, you can never get any strength. I wish I had some help right there. Let me just hit rewind and say it again. If you never go through anything, how can you know how strong you are? I wish I had some help. In order for a flower, now, y'all, I got to quit. I didn't mean to go this far. But in order for a flower to live, a flower, yes, it needs sunshine. But the flower can't always live in the sunshine. Because if the flower only lives in sunshine, it would wither and dry up. So in order for a flower to grow, it needs both the sunshine and the rain. What are you going with this? I'm glad you asked. In our own lives, yes, we all appreciate when the sun is shining. But in order to have maturity, in order to have growth, you also need a little rain. Sometimes God allows trouble to come. Because you must understand that a faith that's never tested is a faith that can't be trusted. Is my microphone on? Let me say that again. A faith that cannot be tested is a faith that cannot be trusted. And so in times of trouble, God helps to build us up. and make us stronger. Do I have a witness right there? Is that all? The writer says, not only is the Lord my light, not only is he my salvation, not only is he my strength, but David says, of whom shall I be afraid? Now, when God is on your side, there's nobody left to fear. Do I have a witness right there? It was Martin Luther that said that that one with God equals a majority. It was J.I. Packer in his book entitled Knowing God. He says that when you know God, taking losses and bearing crosses don't matter, because you know the God who will sustain you. Have I got a witness right there? So if we're going to hold on during tough times, not only do we have God's provisions, but secondly, we have God's protection. It's right there in verse number 2. He says, when the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came up against me to eat of my flesh, they stumbled and they fell. I believe that David took a retrospective look back through the rearview mirror of his past experiences. And he looked up under the letter B and the letter L. The letter B for bear and the letter L for lion. You will remember before David made it to the palace, he started out in the pasture. And while in the pasture, he was tending to his father's sheep. And while tending to his father's sheep, a bear came out of the wild and tried to devour his father's sheep. And David killed the bear with his hands. Then there was a lion that came out of the wild and tried to devour his father's sheep, and he killed the lion with his bare hands. Well, I hadn't seen no lions and bears lately. And the ones that I have seen were on the other side of the cage. But we have people that come to church that have bear and lion mentalities. You can tell a person that has a bear and lion mentality. They're never satisfied. They're always upset about something. They don't like the IHRSA president. Can't stand the mission president. Hates the choir president. They talk about the music is too loud and the pastor holds service too long. They feel like nobody else in the church can do it but them. They get mad when their name is not on the program. They have a problem when someone else tries to give an idea. They're always trying to block the vision that God gives the pastor. They don't like to see the church moving forward. They find something wrong with everything. They always got a problem with everybody, but can't find Genesis in the Bible. A bear and lion mentality. All they want to do is tear down and destroy. Do I have a witness here? But David says, now, hold on. When you run into people that have bear and lion mentalities, he says, God, if you leave it alone, God will step in. Do I have a witness right there? And God will make them lay down at your feet. Do I have a witness right there? But then watch verse number 3. He says, though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. The war should rise against me. In this will I be confident. Now, I hate to have to tell us this, but you need to understand that all of us got enemies. Well, since I told you that, I might as well tell you this other one. More than likely, you got more than one. And I might as well tell you this last piece. In today's vernacular, you don't pick your enemies. Your enemies pick you. Sister had walked in church. She wasn't bothering nobody. She had on a hat. And there was another sister sitting on the back row. And the sister with the hat walked in. She said, "Ooh, that's a beautiful hat. Oh, that's just a lovely hat." She said, "Thank you, baby." And she went on down the aisle. And when she walked off, the lady that gave her the compliment said, "Old cow." Folks, sometimes just the woman wasn't bothering her. She just wore a hat to church. She wanted to look cute. But there was somebody else that had a problem with the woman's hat. There's just folk that will just that can't stand you just because. Look at what David says in this third verse. He says, though an host, now that means more than one, should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Now watch this. I hope you can see beneath the printed words. He says, there is an host that has encamped against me. These are people that knew David. These are people that had been hanging out at the house, you know. These are people that knew how he would think in battle. They knew his hiding places. They were people that he had confided in. And let me just tell you this. Can't nobody hurt you like the people who are closest to you. Is my microphone on? Did I say something wrong? I mean, people who you've confided in, people who you've told your innermost secrets to, people who you've cried to and talked about intimate things that you wouldn't dare share with anybody else, only to discover that they had been using it all along to try to tear you down. And so these were people that knew David. They were people that fought with David. There were people who had hung out with David. Now they've turned on David. And so they've gone up the road and they're waiting on him, not to throw him no surprise party, but they wanted to take David out. Did you hear what I just said? They wanted to take him out. And listen, there are people who would love to rejoice in your going through. Do I have a witness right there? And so David is saying, wait a minute. I've had some important people in my life to turn on me. They know my hiding places. There are at least two instances that writers try to assimilate this 27th number of the psalm. Some say that it's when Saul got after David. And then others say, well, no, it was when Absalom got after David. But whichever case, whether it was King Saul or his son Absalom, they were after David because they wanted him dead. David says, when people that I trust turn on me, I'm still confident because I got God on my side. And maybe that's a word for somebody in here this morning. Regardless of who turns on you, regardless of who talks about you, regardless of who tries to stab you in your back, there is somebody else that will take care of you. Have I got a witness here? And David says, I'm confident because this ain't the first time that I've had to face an enemy. This ain't the first time that I've had to face opposition. And if God has done it once, he can do it again. And maybe that's a word for somebody in here. This ain't the first time you've had to go through anything, you know. This ain't the first time you've had to face opposition. This ain't the first time you've had to deal with burdens. But I'm here to tell you, if God can get you through it in the past, he's got enough to get you through what you're going through right now. Woo! I got to quit. But story was told about five sisters who walked to church, and as they were on their way home from church, they talked about everybody in the church. Can I get a little bit more volume in the monitors? They talked about everybody in the church. They took, as they were walking, they dropped off the first sister. They said, all right, baby. She went on in. They started Peaceway. You got to be kind of old to know what Peaceway down the road. They started Peaceway down the road, and they started talking about her. They went on by the second sister's house. She went on in. They started Peaceway on down the road. They started talking about her. But when they got to the third sister's house, she kept walking. And finally somebody said, now, baby, didn't we pass your house? She said, yes. She said, but we didn't talk about everybody in the church. Talked about the first sister and the second sister. She said, I was just afraid y'all were going to talk about me. So she said, now, today, I'm going to walk y'all home. Amen. All of us got enemies. But notice here, and for the sake of time, notice verse number 5. David says, for in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret place of his tabernacle shall he hide me. Where is this secret place in the tabernacle? You will remember in the tabernacle there was a veil. But behind the veil was a place called the Holies of Holies. Couldn't know anybody go back there. You could if you wanted to. God would strike you down. However, God invested power in the priest to be able to go behind the veil. And he had to be careful of how he went in, just in case he went in with a bad spirit, God would strike him down. So if God was to strike the priest down, they couldn't go back there and get him. So they would have to tie a rope around his ankle, just in case he went in with a bad spirit, and just in case God struck him down, they would have to pull him from behind the Holies of Holies. But behind the Holies of Holies, back there, there was a seat called the mercy seat. And the priests would sprinkle blood on the mercy seat for the atonement of sin. Where are you going with this? David is saying, not only does God protect me from my enemies, but he also covers me with his mercy. Okay, let me make one more round, because I don't think some of y'all you didn't catch it. Now in verse 3, they're plotting on David. But they're also talking about them. You know, some folk can be cruel. They'll bring up your past, and they'll try to hang you out there and talk about your mistakes. They'll say you ain't no good. You ain't this and you ain't that. And so while they're trying to kill David, they're trying to also destroy his reputation. And so David says, well, God is my protector. But even though they're trying to talk about me, God still covers me with his mercy. Woo! Now watch this, I'm through. Some years ago, my dad has been deceased for several years, but before he passed, he came to live with me because he had gotten weak. He had cancer, and so what happened was he was confined to a wheelchair. I had to feed him, I had to clothe him, I had to bathe him. And my dad would always tell me, son, be careful how you treat people, because you never know how life is going to turn out. And so here he is. I watched him take care of Big Mama. I watched him take care of Aunt Lucille. And the day came when somebody else had to take care of him. Are y'all still with me here? So he's living with me. His mind is still good. So I get him and I take him with me to the convention. And so while we are at the convention, we're through with the morning session, and then we go eat. While we are sitting at the table, I go get his food. I make sure he's got everything he needs. Now watch this. I'm engaged in conversation with a pastor to my right. My dad is in the wheelchair eating to his left. And I notice that everybody gets up from the table. They jump up, and I turn to my left. And my dad has spilled red punch all over these people's white plastic tablecloth. So I'm talking to him. I said, now, Dad, you know, if you needed something, all you had to do was tell me. I get up and get it for you. I really want for your last days to be your best days. And so while I'm talking, the pastor that I was engaged in conversation with comes back with a towel. He turns to my dad with a smile and says, Pastor Jackson, don't worry about it. I got you covered. And he begins to start wiping up all of the red punch that was on the white plastic tablecloth. Yeah, okay, y'all didn't, you didn't get it. Let me see if I can say it one more time. My dad had spilled red punch all over the white plastic tablecloth. Another pastor comes with a towel and says to my dad, don't worry, I got you covered. Where are you going with this? I'm almost through. Over 2,000 years ago, Adam had spilled blood everywhere. Sin was everywhere. And Jesus says to humanity, don't you worry about it. I got you covered. God will protect us. God will cover us with his mercy. I'm almost through. I got one more verse. I'm in my seat. Not only does God give us his provisions, not only does God give us his protection, but David says, this provides for me a reason to praise him. I ain't making it up. It's right there in verse number 6. The writer says, and now shall my head be lifted up above my enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. He says, I will sing. Yea, I will sing praises unto the Lord. Apparently, and I'm through, David had made a vow that if God was to get him out of this, he vowed that if he could make it to the sanctuary, he was going to give God some praise. And that's why he starts verse 6 with a conjunction. He says, and now. You didn't catch it. Just a little while ago, my enemies thought they had gotten the best of me. But now, God has brought me through it. I wish I had some help in here. They tried to defame my name. They tried to ruin me in the community. But now God has favored me in the same community that they tried to ruin me in. And now. y'all still with me here? And so David says, in essence, that since God has been providing for me, David says, since the Lord has given me strength, David says that I will give God praise. David says, since the Lord has protected my life, since the Lord has covered me with his mercy, David says that I'm going to give God some praise. Have I got a witness here? David says, since the Lord has been leading me, and since the Lord has been protecting me, I will give God praise. Ooh, I've got to leave you now. But I think I need to tell you, if God has made a way in your life, and if God has opened doors that's been closed in your face, you ought to lift your hands and tell God thank you. Yeah, if the Lord has watched over you, and if the Lord has been keeping you, and if the Lord has put food on your table, you ought to tell the Lord, I sure do thank you. Is there anybody here? Know for yourself that God has been good to you. Is there anybody here? No, had it not been for the Lord who was on your side, tell me, where would you be? Oh, I got to leave you alone, but can I bother you? Can you turn and point at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, be not dismayed. Whatever betide, God will take care of you. Won't he do it? I said, won't he do it? Oh, won't the Lord take care of you? Won't the Lord watch over you? Do I have a witness here? I've got to get out of here, but I never shall forget my daddy. He told me before he died, he said, boy, there's gonna come a time when you're gonna have to cry in the midnight hour. He said, boy, there's gonna come a time when you're gonna have to fall on. He said, but I want you to remember, when life gets harder, when you can't see, when you can't see your way, I want you to look up toward heaven and tell the Lord, my Lord, I
need you right now. He said, and then whatever you do, make sure you hold on until your change come. Is there anybody here? No, if you can hold on, your change is on the way. If you can hold on, your breakthrough is on the way. And while I'm waiting, I'm gonna give God praise. While I'm waiting, I'm gonna tell the Lord, thank you, thank you. Ow. Come on, don't fool me. Can you tell God thank you? Hadn't he been good to you? What can I ask you? And he all right? Do you know he's all right? Say it. Yeah. Say it.
Stand all over the house. We extend the invitation. Come on, we've heard a powerful word. We know what it's like to experience difficult days, tough times. But I'm glad tough times don't last, but tough people do. And all the reason we have tough people, the Lord has preserved us and protected us. He has put a host all around us that in the time of trouble, he will hide us. We extend the invitation. We invite you to come here out of church, need a church home. New Hope is a wonderful place to be. I invite you to come. You need a pastor. Don't try to make life without a pastor. You need a pastor who can cover you and pray for you and preach to you and give you leadership. You need a church home. You need a place to belong. You need a place where you are connected. It's not enough just to attend worship. You need to be a part of worship. And then you need people that you can literally call sisters and brothers. Everybody in the fellowship may not be fit, but there are some saints. There are some people of God who believe in prayer, who believe in praise, and who believe in you. And we ask that you will make today your day. Come on, meet us at this altar if I'm talking to you. Come on, we trust that you'll come.